Welcome back once again to your celestial one-stop shop for all things seventh. Last week I told you we had enough episodes for a squad to enter a World Series podding event, but this is episode 14, meaning that were all our audio messages in a bottle to wash upon the shores of the South Pacific, then they'd be able to play a little 7-on-7. However, should that beach belong to the islands of Fiji and the locals fancied a run, then they'd be up against a nation inspired by today's guest and Sevens deity, Ben Ryan, who steered those Islands of Davids to Rio gold against the Rugby Goliaths back in 2016. And today steps into the clouds with myself, Burnsy, Mitch and Chip. This ain't the Corona cast. This ain't the lockdown. Listen along, prepare to be elevated to a higher state of rugby consciousness, because this is seventh heaven.
Excellent, excellent, Burnsy. Very good. Painting the picture nicely there.
There's Island Discs theme to seventh heaven. Copyright patent pending. Enjoyed that, Burnsy. Top. Nice way to start the show.
As any regular listener will know from our intro music, that we laugh in the face of copyright infringement here in seventh heaven.
Do you know what I find amazing about your intros is that you bang them out like with just first time. You never have to do a rerun. You never have to edit them together. You just bash them out there and then in front of our eyes. It's amazing.
Burnsy loves bashing them out in front of our eyes, especially on the new format of Skype. Burnsy, is it true that you had stocks in chat roulette?
It is incorrect. A bit chat roulette-y, isn't it, on this?
Yeah, on the topic, yeah, on the intro, Mitch is good at crossfield kicks. Chippy, you're good at wearing headgear. I'm good at intros. I mean,
I knew you were going to say that. I knew as soon as you started speaking, I was like, he's going to get into headgear. You know, I've been thinking about retiring it.
Really? How do you retire the headgear? Surely you're so accustomed to wearing it.
Yeah, no, you just tape your ears up instead. I do that in training, like for contact sessions, and it feels fine. I don't know what it is about wearing the lid. I shouldn't really wear it. I don't know. Whatever. I've got a gammon sewed on the side of my head, so we've got to look after the other good one.
Is that speaking what you wear from the ears?
Yeah, because this one, you know, the collie, that one, yeah, it doesn't bend. So if it gets hit, it'll like explode or rip off. I'm not keen for either of them, really.
Speaking from a very amateur standpoint, when I played 15s, I wore headgear, but when I played 7s, I didn't, because I found it inhibited my peripheral vision. Do you not find that the case?
I've got blinkers on me. It's pretty tight to the side of your bonce, like it doesn't come over your eyes. I can see. The main reason I can't see in sevens is because I'm absolutely blowing.
Well, surely wearing the headgear marks you out. You want to keep it on, mate.
Why? Marks me out for attackers or defenders?
No, just like for the people watching, you know, for the commentators, for the fans.
For my mum.
Yeah. I found in my pomp that it added a layer of subterfuge to your game, that players would look at you and they'd underestimate you. And then when you put the afterburners or the afterburnsies on, as I used to call them, then they'd be left scratching their head, wishing that they had a head guard on to deceive the opposition like myself. Do you ever find that, Chip, that people underestimate you because you got a scrum hat on?
Nah, they underestimate me because I'm a bit bigger than them. They're like, oh, he's going to be slow. And then I'm like, see ya.
You've been doing the same sprint sessions at Burnsy then, have you?
That's it. We were about the same speed anyway. I faced our nuts on, I did speed up one day. I faced our nuts and he actually gave me like an online tutorial video thing. It was like invaluable. Like, because he was one-on-one, he's actually serious. I know it sounds gimpy, but he was like, oh, try this drill, try this. And after I did it, I was like, wow, I feel quick.
Isn't it funny that we've both known and played with Norts for so long, and it's really rare that you get him to help you in training and actually give you a moment of being serious? Like, do you see his Instagram story where he said he was missing the gym mostly because he could shout the boys and slag them off? And I was just thinking, that is so true. I don't miss that at all. The number of times I've gone to him in the gym and asked for help with their exercise or some speed techers, and he won't give you anything. He'll just watch you do it and then laugh at you because of how shit you are at it compared to him.
The best thing is when you ask him for spot, he's like, if you can't lift it up yourself, you should be lifting it.
I've got to give him a shout out because we started off in a lowly position on the pod. And so we've got to be nice to our loyal listeners. And my family give me updates every week. They all listen. My sister listens. My aunties listen. My cousin, who's a big fan. It's great. And I just wanted to give him a shout out and say we appreciate it. Not just my family, but all the other loyal listeners out there. Keep it up.
So we'll shout out Rory as well and Will Muir, who are the two fans. So,
well, yes, in this unprecedented time of the use of the word unprecedented, people have been voting with their eardrums. And yeah, last episode was our most listened to ever. So the numbers are climbing, the love is being felt, and the listenership is staying pretty loyal. So thank you very much to you guys. And if you could continue to like, share, and subscribe on whatever platform you're getting your pod fix from, then that'd be much appreciated by myself, Chip, and Mitch.
And I'm sure this one is going to go to new heights. Pretty excited about this one.
Is going to go to new heights. Got to give a few shout outs though as well. Shave, nominate, donate. Your teammate, Alex Davies, they are around about £26,000 mark now.
It's epic. Great work, all involved. Well done.
So keep plugging away at that. Obviously, elsewhere in the rugby community, Ed Jackson's climbed his flight of stairs millions of times to raise about 40 grand. And Barnes Rugby Club are doing a million kilo lifting challenge on Saturday to raise money for the NHS that lots of people are getting behind. So you can check out their charity efforts with all the proceeds going to the NHS.
It's cool, isn't it? The things people are doing. It really is kind of, it's uplifting. Amazing things people are willing to put themselves through and just get organized in order to help. It's cool. It gives me a warm, fuzzy feeling inside.
Yeah, and Richmond as well. The Richmond Heavies Foundation did a 2.6 challenge on Sunday, raising money for mental awareness. So everyone's getting stuck in. It's good. It's brought out the best in people. Lockdown ain't that bad. Other people who've been in touch, other loyal listeners, Asthma UK have been in touch just to inquire as to whether you're all right, Chippy, after a particularly heavy breathed episode with Rory and Marcus. What was going on?
So basically, I come on to you, Burnsy, and say, listen, I want to be a professional podcaster, and I'm a bit concerned after listening back is why I'm always going on the pod and then use it against me with a made up allegation and made up call. Joe, I'm coming here to grow as a person and as a podcaster. I don't need you to put me down.
brave but foolish words from a man to the other bloke who edits the pod and manipulates everything. And Mitch, a bit of feedback for you. Can you hurry up and produce some viral content? I mean, Jim Hamilton is doing reverse passes into a bin, and you have produced nothing. I can't believe I overlooked Carlos Spencer for you when we were trying to put this team sheet together.
Well, I still haven't forgotten that you didn't come to me first anyway. You went to Chippy, and then you asked for Norts. And I haven't forgotten that. I know I'm second fiddle in all of this. So before you pull at that thread, just bear that in mind. And with regards to the viral content, like, I mean, there's a lot of dodgy efforts out there that you have like 10 or 20 goes at it, you're going to get it. Now, I don't think that's impressive.
Are you referring to Master Carlin Isles with the toe bung drop goal through a door, which was the most disgusting strike I've ever seen in my entire life?
I've done my best to try and forget that, Chip, but thanks for bringing it up. Yeah, I mean, I just hope Noor or Maddie are giving him some tips on his kicking techers, because that was horrific. But fair play, he's obviously stuck at it for a while and he's got it through the thing, and he's the king of content, so I won't argue.
Go on then, boys. What have you been up to?
Busy morning for me this morning, Burnsy. On a night shift last night with Rudy. So I got up early, went for a run, fasted cardio, inspired by my captain, Tom Mitchell. Had a bit of breakfast. Apart from that, not a lot. My birthday this week, so looking a bit sad and lonely for that, but be fine.
Happy birthday, Chip. How old are you going to be? It's tomorrow, isn't it? Or yesterday, if people are listening to this on Friday.
Yeah, be 30, fortunately.
Big 3-0. How are you marking it?
Sitting inside with my family.
Woohoo!
Nothing planned, really. I think Annika is going to make me a cake. I might have a couple of beers, I don't know. We'll have a shindig when this is all over.
Too right, we will.
Cannot wait for the seventh heaven end of season social.
Woo! Mini chicken Kievs for all. Fair play to your missus on that first episode. She put a hell of a spread on, and I was thinking, yeah, I could get used to this podcasting life. Never to be seen again.
She's got very, very big into baking cakes, as you might be able to tell from my waistline. So there could be a cake and episode when we get out of lockdown.
Outstanding.
Between the cakes and the glove boxing, mate, you're in trouble, aren't you?
Mitch, what have you been up to? Sorry, kind of hijacked that bit.
Yeah, not a lot to report. I've been doing a bit of training. I'm quite enjoying the training, actually. It was hard to get into it a couple of weeks ago, but now I feel like I'm back in the groove a bit. Enjoying getting out to the park, doing some running for my one a day. And then, other than that, just been actually exploring around rugby, just kind of picking a few threads outside of rugby, exploring potential options. As you said, that's because the process is very vague as well. You know what it's like trying to think about life after rugby, because half your brain switches off because you don't want to acknowledge it. So then you're trying to engage what's left and then and trying to do something practical.
Yeah, I was laying in bed last night thinking of you two and thought about...
talk to me more about that, Bansy. What were you wearing?
I'll tell you part one. You have to pay a subscription for part two.
a teaser.
But I was just thinking about, you know, your lives after rugby. And it's so rare for anyone to, at the age of 20 or 18, I don't know when you guys exactly turn professional, 20, 21, who goes into a career and stays in there for 10 years from the word go. It's pretty rare these days. And you never waver from leaving. I think a lot of people go into careers and they're in there for a short time, then they have doubts and then they persist. Whereas, you know, you're living the dream, basically. So, you know, it must be a very daunting thought after this. I don't want to go too deep here.
That's always your case, Burns, isn't it? it is daunting, but it's exciting as well. You've got to pick the positives out of everything, especially the situation we're in at the moment. Yeah, like new experiences, going to be class, whatever we do next. Me and Mitch are both like putting wheels in motion now. We're guided and funded, guided by the RPA, who help us get in to do things after rugby and encourage us to do things. And especially with England Sevens at the moment, the programme, the way the state is in at the moment, they're encouraging us to look and try and plan for after rugby. So, yes, it's exciting, a little bit daunting, but whatever comes next will be a welcome change.
That's it, and it's the shift of perspective away from, there was obviously going to be the fear there, but seeing the opportunity to do something new rather than it being the black hole is the way you kind of got to look at it, I think.
Also as well, I think it was last week, AJ sent me a picture, a random one, you know, on the time hop when it sends you back. And he sent me a picture of Bali from the Commonwealth Games. I'm on the beach with a medal on and I've got a beer and shorts on and a t-shirt because I'm keeping the rig tucked under, especially after a couple of beers getting bloated up. But I was just thinking, what a bloody journey we've been on. And if it ends tomorrow, I'm happy with where we've been. And I'm just like grateful for the opportunity. I'm not retiring myself now. I think that's the theme of these podcasts, retiring myself.
Yeah.
That's the realization you come to when you think about it for long enough. It's been
fun. It's true though, but then I flip between those feelings of gratitude and then being, you know, content with it, but then also wanting to cling on so tight to all the good stuff and wanting more of it.
As a famous actor once said, I'm not fucking leaving. But I'm not.
You've used that before.
I'll go again.
All right, guys, we got a huge guest on today. One we've been very excited about getting on for a long, long time. Set the scene for me.
Yeah, so Banjo was the guy who gave me and Chip our first start on the World Series, my first entry into professional rugby. So very grateful and nice to get him on, and hopefully we'll chat a bit about that. And a massive name in the game.
Nothing to add to that, Mitch. Excited to get him on.
Yeah, that's right. Our guest today needs little introduction as he follows pretty hot on the heels of sidestepping Serevi in the pecking order of Seven's favourite sons, which is rather apt as it was with Fiji that he achieved his greatest coaching triumph, though this didn't happen overnight. He donned the tracksuit of Teddy School Oxford, Newbury in the Championship and England Sevens before hopping on a plane to Rio via Suva and proving to be the man with the Midas touch, returning from the 2016 Olympics with Fiji's first ever medal, and the colour was gold. Ben Ryan is in seventh heaven. How are you, Ben?
What have you been doing to pass the time then in lockdown?
I've had a project I was doing with UK Sport that finished about, I don't know, 10 days ago, and that was all written project. And then I've just done a couple of Skypes with a few clubs that I'm still working with, but generally trying to be proactive and not really succeeding.
It's tough, isn't it? It's tough to get stuff done.
Yeah, it is. I've supposed to be doing my French every day. I'm supposed to be just doing my outline for my new second book. And I've got another thing I've got to do, and I just haven't done it yet. So, no excuse, really.
What are you using to learn French?
I've tried everything. So I used to go to Lycée Français for lessons in South Kent, and then I went to, and that wasn't working. And then I did an online tutor, and then I'm Duolingo and reading and watching. And that seems to be the best so far.
There is an excellent eclair shop called Maitre Choux by the Lycée in South Cairn.
I'm all over it. I know it, yeah.
How good are those eclairs?
Yeah, it's ridiculous. They're like works of art, aren't they?
what's the teaser for the next book, Banjo? Yeah, I know. Chippy, that's your favourite subject, mate. Banjo, what's the teaser for the book then? The next one, just drop that in there slightly.
Yeah, it's a kind of leadership / business book, really. So I'm just doing it with someone, a psychology based kind of business book. So yeah, just getting it together now.
Cool.
Not very interesting, is it?
When can we expect that one?
Well, you're closed book, Banjo. You're not giving as much there.
It's like, well, you know, I can't. I've done all my rugby chat. You know, that there's not a lot more to add to any of that the lawyers didn't take out on my first book. So you know, that's where we are.
Was there a lot that was cut from it, was there?
There was quite a lot, actually, yeah. There's some silly stuff that's cut that I just didn't, but lawyers have to be super careful, because if you get one person that decides to do something, to put say you've been libelous, and they win, you've got to kind of, all those books have to get mulched, and there's a pretty heavy cost, and the author has to take that on the shoulders generally. So there were one or two where they said it would be my responsibility if they sued us, and I just didn't want to take that risk. But yeah, I put enough stuff in there that, you know, made it interesting.
So if Simon wrote a book and said that Chippy didn't get picked for the last Olympics because he was too fat, I could sue him?
If that was factually incorrect, you could.
I'll get my skinfold graphs up then. We'll go to court.
That's it. So where are you guys? Yeah, Chippy, you're in Isle of Wight. Are you in South London, Mitch? You're not allowed to train or anything like that?
Well, there's nowhere to go to train other than the back garden and the park. But it's quite nice in a way, because you've got a kind of back to basic stuff, like the stuff you used to do when you were younger and you had no idea what training was supposed to look like.
Yeah, sweet. I saw that the The Fiji have got the coronavirus down to almost nothing now. So they are allowing meetings of less than 20, which basically means the national team will be back training now. So they're going to get a little bit of a head start, I think, on everyone else.
Did you hear Hugo Monet's suggestion earlier in the week that rugby, when it returns, should be uncontested scrums for the first 2 weeks so that players can bed themselves into the physicality and then ramp it up to full-blown rugby in an effort to get the game started sooner?
It's interesting, isn't it? I think they're just definitely going to have... Burnsy, sorry I didn't ask where you are.
That's all right, mate.
It looks delightful.
Ben, no one cares.
Yeah, the listeners don't want to know.
Well, in answer to your question, I think they've definitely got to have some. They're going to have some law changes. Just, and I know in football, some of the stuff I do with them, they're going to be they're expanding their bench and the number of substitutions. I actually think, not that it's a plug, but you know that I think some of the Rugby X laws, they could actually bring in, for example, rolling subs, and not do it so that it's a complete mess where it's taking up loads of time. But if they just did it at tries that were scored as well as the normal seven subs, I think you might have a bit more flexibility in the early, because two games a week's just going to be a disaster, I think, on the body.
That brings us nicely to something that I wanted to ask, just to kick things off, Ben, that for the casual rugby observer, you're now involved with France Sevens. You've dabbled a little bit with Wales Sevens, but I think a lot of people would like to know why you haven't been more prominent in the coaching world of rugby in the last 4 years, because we're coming up to quite a big anniversary of a big moment in your life. But I think a lot of people would have anticipated seeing you kick on into more 15-a-side and are more prevalent in sevens still.
A number of reasons, really, I guess. Firstly, I wasn't with Wales. I had literally one meeting, signed a contract sort of on a handshake, and when I got there, it just wasn't what they wanted and what I wanted, really. So there was no dramas around that, but it didn't fit. And then France has been a kind of a slow burner, really. So I really enjoy working with Jérôme, the head coach. He's fantastic, and I really like the boys, and they're good fun. And and that I do quite a lot of stuff off field. So the top 14 tournament that we ran last year in Paris, and we're supposed to be having a series of those tournaments running in August in France, which isn't going to happen now with the government putting that law down for anything till September. Well, it does mean Paris Sevens does mean it could still be played. So that'll be interesting. Have I managed to then side with that question so I don't have to talk about why I'm not doing any rugby now?
Yeah, Banj, well dodged.
Thank you.
Well dodged. A season pro.
There's none of that in Seventh Heaven, Banj.
Yeah. We've come across someone who's a lot smarter than us.
Look, I just knew that when I left Fiji, I needed to leave Fiji for a number of reasons. And then I did think I was going to go back into 15s. I did have a couple of head coach offers at good clubs, and got down to the point where we were talking numbers, and I didn't feel that I really wanted to do the day to day, and everything had been, you know, I had one offer that really ticked all my boxes, but it still wasn't enough for me to want to go back. So that's really why. Sevens, I never really wanted to go back round traveling. If you could just drop you into a tournament and you can do the 2 day tournament or 3 days, and then also drop me into the half day off at a coffee shop or restaurant in some of those locations, then I'm in. But I'd done it for so long, and you move on. So I miss the tournaments and the excitement, and I love that roller coaster of the 2 days and six games and all that sort of stuff. But you know, I don't really want to go back full time. I wouldn't say no to an Olympic opportunity, but that still kind of really not fits in with my ethos that you need to be embedded properly in teams. So that's it, really. I did want to go back part time. So I did have a conversation with a Premiership club about going part time, but part time for them was 4 days a week and the weekend, and that for me wasn't enough of part time. So I don't know now whether with maybe the financial stresses on the Premiership, and they might be cutting down staff, that actually a part time role in the Prem might now be an option. Who knows?
What is it about going back to 15s that you'd find attractive, and what are kind of the, some of the things that maybe put you off when you turned down those offers before?
I think the attractive bit is the, it's got to be careful. Like, it's something that we all have to deal with, and I've had to deal with it a lot, is ego, and my ego and other people's egos. And when I get into 15, want to do 15s, it's generally my ego that's driving that. I want to show everyone that I can do just as well or better in 15s than I did in 7s. And that's my ego, really. I'd be excited about just wanting to do different things that I did way back with the Newbury in the championship about 15 odd years ago when we were doing all sorts of different things. And I'd like to try some of that stuff that I think will work in 15s, but a lot of it is ego driven. And what I don't particularly like is the day to day. I hate doing analysis. I hate doing meetings. I much rather have put the autonomy on the players. I like to slim down all of that. I much prefer the Saracens model of less training. And certainly if I was in charge of a Prem club, I'd be cutting down a lot of what they were doing and having a lot less meetings. And so you know, those sort of things are ingrained a bit in the Premiership, and I'd like to change them, but I'm not sure I'd be given that opportunity. So that's it. And then overseas, I've had options to go overseas as well, but I've kind of just moved back to London. It feels like I've just moved back. I'm, you know, settled here with Michelle, and we're really enjoying life in London. So at the moment, although we've talked about having an opportunity in the future to go overseas, it's kind of, it just suits everything else at the moment.
I was chatting to another journalist, John Newcomb, mentioned about having you on the pod. And he was asking, further to your 15s coaching, that do you think that some 15 sides in your time have been put off by your methods or your invention? So when you're at Newbury, it was viewed as very inventive. You had great success, but then maybe too avant-garde for Premiership.
I think at the time, so yeah, Newbury, like we did play a high risk game, and we did do lots of different things. We used backline formations. We had a libero role, so Damu was selected as just in whatever position he wanted to. So he'd name 14 players, and then Damu. He got man of the match twice playing libero, and he kind of played around at 12, 8, 11, and it was quite fun doing that. And it just gets everyone else thinking about, like, you know, if you've got a libero and you've got a scrum on midfield halfway, well, and you've got Damu sticking on the wing, well, maybe you put him in at number 8, and maybe you put in, it just gave the players more, like, emotional understanding of the game. And I really enjoyed all of that. And I had Brian Ashton with me helping me as well. So, that was a real think tank that we had. And I was young then. And so trying to get a job in the Premiership then as a head coach or was going to be a reach. And then England came in for sevens. And then, I don't know if you know the original story, but myself and Mark Mapletoft were asked to apply for the under 20s job. And then the sevens came up, and then they basically said, look, we want you both to work for the RFU. We've got these two teams. Ben, you know slightly more about sevens than Tofty. So how about you do sevens, Tofty does 20s, and in a year we'll review it. And then the year came and we were like, yeah, cool. And then a year later, we both said, like, we're quite enjoying what we're doing. And so we stuck with it. And so it could have been Mark Mapletoft you were talking to now, and he might have been the one that had got the gold in Rio.
Banj, you talked about changing things, and you said about more rolling subs and bringing stuff from Rugby X in. If you had a couple of changes, two or three changes to make to the series, what would your top ones be that you could think of?
Yeah, good one. I think formats I'd have a crack at. I think it depends which way we're going to go. So, like, in the great scheme of things, if we had a year-round seven series and we had a bottomless budget, then could you just fly teams in, you play straight knockout games, it's one evening, it's straight knockout, like the old Middlesex Sevens, it's over in 3 hours, you then market that, sell it, and it'd be an IPL type thing now. I think actually as a product that would be unbelievably good and exciting and have so many close games and so many different winners. But you know how hard it is to travel to the other side of the world and the costs of going and maybe playing one game in Sydney and then coming back to London. That's hard. So you have to try and think about how you could wrap other stuff in around that. Or could you play a Saturday night in Sydney and a Wednesday night in Auckland and then come home knowing that you might only play two games, or you might have played a lot that you can, you know, those sort of things I think need to maybe move the dial, because sevens is not a viable sport for production. That no, it's too long, and even the golden couple of hour, golden hour or 2 hours, it doesn't fit. So there's that. In game, I think we need to have a discussion around sevens is about fitness, skills, decision making, end to end excitement. So why is 30% of every game spent kicking or running back after a kick? Is it so important, kicking, to us that we have to have 30% of every game either a kickoff or scoring or a conversion, or after the conversion has been taken, the 20 seconds to walk back to restart? That's a lot of time being taken out for that particular skill. Do we need those breaks for the fitness levels or not? Can we have rolling subs? Can we change things? All those things, I think, just need people in the room that have played the game, that have coached the game, that watched the game, to maybe think about how we can secure the future of sevens.
You have a field goal kicker coming on. I think that could be my little role there.
I mean, you could stop the clock all the time, but then you've got broadcast issues. So I think shaving that time away for me would definitely be, and I hate the scrums at the moment. They are an abomination. Like, South Africa got used to get away with that little roll in, so it's almost like a number eight feed.
Everybody keep it at the back. Yeah,
everybody's doing it now. It's a farce. And that needs to just be wiped out. Either don't have, I mean, we haven't got yet in 15s, right? If you lose a player and then you bring on another front row specialist, they get injured, you go to uncontested scrums. We've never yet had the point where someone's come onto the field. You know, Dan Norton comes onto the field and he's got to go in at hooker, and he goes, "Ref, I'm not a specialist. I'm not, this is not safe." Referee can only have uncontested scrums. No one's done that yet. But under law, he has nowhere else to go around that. And as everyone's getting bigger and more physical, and scrums are getting competitive or getting physical, there runs a risk of more injury. And I think scrums need to be attended to as well. Either do them properly or don't do them, unless there are, you know, find another way of doing things. Or I quite like of having a two-man scrum with a number eight in the back, so you actually can do far more things there. Eight can pick, can roll, can have different moves. That would be quite interesting, I think.
As someone who's been in a total of one scrum in the whole of my World Series career, Banjo, I think you're onto something. It was a solid scrum. I prop that up.
Were you hooking? Were you prop? What were you doing?
No, I slotted in a hooker.
Lovely.
It is true, though, because we use wingers. We bring wingers on and put them in prop. And our scrum suffers for it. And if you think about the health and safety of it, it's not like when you think Tom Bowen, he loves scrummaging, but he's like one of the wingers who comes on. But yeah, it's tough. But
well, technically,
it's a tough one to...
if we defend, we do it, lots of teams do it, the defensive scrum. You put your sweeper in a hooker in your defensive scrum. So, but technically, is that legal?
No, probably not. Yeah, there's so much under law that actually isn't written, you know, and that's another conversation. It's quite a boring one. But I think we need to tidy up on all of that. And I'm a big fan of Craig and Paddy. So I think they would love to do more, I'm sure. But I think sometimes their hands are tied, and maybe we need to have a separate sevens law book to the 15s game, not just an abbreviated law book, but actually make some so we can go the way we want the game to go.
Is there a difficulty with making some of these changes, though, with the fact that the Sevens series encompasses so many different teams at all different levels of funding and development and skill level as well? Does that mean that it's difficult to push the game in some of these areas?
Yeah, probably, because like everyone's budgets are slashed, and so there's lots of different things that are stopping the development of the game. But if you think about, well, how can you get more money into the game? There's a couple of avenues. One is you have to make it a TV-friendly commercial product. You have to bring better quality players that are well-known stars into the game. And you have to have alternate streams of income and younger crowd coming through. So all those things have to happen. And there are, you know, that means you might have to, you know, I don't know many coaches that are going to want to travel to one a tournament and only play one game if they get, but would they do that knowing that their budget's going to have another zero on in a couple of years' time? I don't know. I mean, I would do that as a, you know, if you're overseeing programs. I know it's hard for people on the ground to accept change in a short time span.
Do you think that model of having a straight knockout 3-hour competition can be applied domestically, though? to encourage growth of sevens within a country, because we've got, there's loads of really good invitational teams in the UK, but you see them four times a year in the Super Series. But if you really ramped it up and had Friday night, Wednesday night tournaments with that model, then surely that that would then propel the international game forward as well. Certainly within the UK, I don't know whether it would work in other countries.
Yeah, I mean, look, I don't know how linked in England Sevens pathway is to Super Sevens. I mean, when was the last person that came through Super Sevens to get capped by England? What's the answer for that? Who, has there been anyone?
Can't think of anyone off the top of my head, Banjo. I'm trying to think, maybe some of the young lads have played a bit in Bob's, but I'd imagine that someone had hooks in him before they went and played. Maybe they just went for exposure.
So no one that's suddenly just come to the fore from playing Super Series. And I mean, they're definitely there. I mean, there's no doubt about it. They're definitely in the lower leagues and playing semi-pro and have made different decisions not to, to choose professional rugby, but are, could be international sevens players. No doubt about that. But I think it all needs to be linked up. And I think now is the time as well to really start to bring the Prem into the camp and start to do more with the Premiership. They're all going to be having funds and contracts slashed. And so Sevens could go in and do some good deals there to get some joint ownership of players. And then if you have a wider pool and a bigger pool, then the conversations to have more tournaments and various things can start to happen as well. So, it's so fragile rugby at the moment. We only had 1 or 2 weeks off after coronavirus and already clubs were cutting salaries. So it shows you that it's hand by mouth by a lot of these teams. And it's the same in unions. You know, you guys would have seen it with England with having your budget cut in the last couple of years. It's the same everywhere. There's very few clubs, nations that are loaded with money for sevens programs. So you have to think of financial opportunities.
Do you think Rugby X is something like, on the back of this coronavirus coming back in, something that clubs can use to generate income for themselves? So say we have like a Premiership Rugby X with like a split league North-South.
We've had these conversations across the globe and not just in the UK, you know, for the clubs to make an opportunity to recover some funding. And also, you know, there's no reason why you can't have Rugby X games during the season because they're so short and sharp and there's less onus on injury. You know, you've seen Premiership Rugby when they have the sevens pre-season, there's always at least one serious injury. It's a terrible combination of young academy keenos that are literally going 100 miles an hour with a couple of season pros playing live on TV for the first time in their home stadium, in a big Premiership stadium, and they just get things wrong often and they get over fatigued and they get season ending injuries, and the quality drops really dramatically. So X Rugby at Christmas for the Premiership in a closed stadium would certainly bring more money in. It's the commercial strand as well as the performance strand. And it's bringing in new supporters. It's not necessarily we're saying Rugby X players are going to end up being Test Match superstars. We're also saying it's a vehicle to bring in more money, play the game, bring in different supporters.
But Chip, you weren't a massive fan of the product on the pitch for Rugby X, were you?
Not the first time, no, but I think that's the case with all kind of first tournaments, like Banjo and Mitch will testify to this. Whenever you go to a first tournament, it's just got a couple of teething issues. It was a tough one, that first one we played. At the start of the season, we had a bit of an iffy squad out. We had the kids and me and Norts, I think it was. And think like Norse only had to do it because he was getting paid for it.
it was a shame England put out such a terrible team. But it was good that the women actually, like, they saved England really there by winning that tournament. And you're right, first tournaments, you know, we got some things wrong for sure. The scrums again looked terrible because they had that everyone was playing the scrums like they were in the sevens. So with an extra 5 meters to play with, that was an issue. But I think we were onto something, and I think it's got legs. We've just got to fine tune it like everything else, really.
Yeah, I've said to you, Banjo, I was a fan of it and the concept and everything. I guess putting my like player welfare hat on, which, you know, it does have to be at the forefront of a lot of these changes. And you know what it was like when back in the day when you were coaching with England and some of the tournaments then, there were a lot of issues that really were probably not acceptable in terms of high level professional sport, in terms of some of the standards. And I guess that would be my concern with bringing changes to not just with Rugby X and bringing that in, but, you know, changes to the World Series format and how you've explained it. Like, what's the best way of going about that? In my eyes, you've got to bring the players into the conversation a lot more.
Yeah, too right. Definitely. And that's current players, you know, particularly, and ones that don't have an agenda, coaches that don't have an agenda, administrators and people from outside rugby and in other professional sports that can be disruptors and give us various other options as well. I think all of that stuff needs to come into it, because I love sevens, but I'm never going to sit and watch 2 days of it on telly. I can't, or in the stadium, I can't go through 50 or 60 games, particularly with the men's and women's together. I think the women's game has gone on leaps and bounds, but it should not be running alongside the men's series. And that's not because of any other reason other than women can't get their own sponsorship, costs 30% more in every tournament costs, and they don't get that backing gate. And it makes for a far longer tournament to the detriment of both the men's and women's games. And if the women's became occasionally attached, but actually start to create their own series and really put some resource and funding and money behind that so that they can start to really boost their own journey, I think that will improve things. I can see why they did it. And they must have thought it's about having equal opportunity, which I'm 100% for. But I actually don't think it's created that. I think it's actually damaged both. And so I think there's a way of maybe trying to change that now, adjust all that. So there's a whole load of stuff that we could do to change. But it does require people to sit down, have honest conversations and make some fairly radical changes.
One night in heaven. Speaking of change, Bunch, it's all changed since me and you first started. Jeez, that feels like absolute age ago.
Yeah, well, in Edinburgh.
Does that make you
it?
Feel old, Bunch?
Well, it was in Edinburgh, yeah, when you played against... Did you play against Fiji in the... You played against Fiji?
Yeah, that's it. You put me on twice on the first day, but as the full-time whistle was going, so I jogged on. At least full-time whistle went, I was like... Oh,
that was a little bit better than Rodders. I think Rodders' first tournament, I didn't put him on at all for six games, just sat on the bench.
Don't worry, we reminded him of it a few times.
Nortz tells him every single time he brings up the record.
Nortz did the same as well. He sat on the bench a fair bit in his first couple of tournaments. That was when you could only put 3 out of 5 on, wasn't it, I think?
Hectic. Me and Mitch were chatting. Was that when we first started, were your fitness sessions just disgusting, or were we really unfit, or was it a combo of both?
Yeah, I think when I started, I had less... people coming from above telling me about what we had to do and what we couldn't do as far as contact and training and all that sort of stuff. And we would do some hard old school training, where a lot of it was playing games, a lot of it was shuttling diagonals, suicides, things like that, you know. And we used to do if any of the boys would remember pre-Delhi Commonwealth Games, we used to do lots of back-to-back RFU fitness tests, so we just do them one after another.
Thank God I was never around for that.
I remember, Dan Nortz back then was super fit on that, and Dan Caprice was the king of that. Actually, I think he was ridiculously good at doing those back to backs. I did that with Fiji as well, but with a yo-yo, I do the yo-yo test, and we do it up to half a dozen times. It is more mental than physical when you get to that sort of level.
I remember doing that back-to-back test for the first time, and it was after we'd had a week off. And being the fresh pants that I was back when you were Coach Ben, I just, you know, still with my university student's head on, thought, oh, week off, like, you do what you want. It wasn't the best attitude back then after I spent a week in Marbella with a few of my uni mates, and then came back in, and day one we had the back-to-back fitness test. After the second one, after it finished, I honestly couldn't see, and we went straight into doing some skills stuff, and I honestly was really struggling to see the ball that we were passing. I'll never forget that pain.
I really like hearing stuff like that. It's cool. There was thought behind it, because back in the day it was me and Brett Davison were there, and Sevens had a bit of a I didn't think Sevens was going to survive post about 2008 or 2009. It was when the EPS agreement came in. Rob Andrew cut a deal for everyone, but the senior team got loads of central, you know, they got lots of time available to train, but to the detriment of age groups and sevens. And suddenly from being able to call upon Premiership players. I couldn't call upon Premiership Reg 9, which was available, which then meant we could go down to Championship and call in players. That disappeared. So we had no decent players to call upon, or anybody could have turned us down at any club. And we needed to get something, a USP that gave us a bit of kind of a standard within the union. And we thought, well, look, if we really put fitness at the top of the agenda and get these boys super fit, and the national team were also putting an onus under that as well at the time with Jono, and they were doing the RFU test. So let's do two of them. Let's do a back-to-back and start to show everybody how fit Sevens players were. And so it kind of stemmed from that, really, as well as, like, in my first year, there was a cupboard where Mike Snelling, the old physio, used to stay. And we found some GPS units in there that Clive Woodward had bought for the team. They'd used once, didn't like them, discarded them. And so me and Brett thought, well, let's try and chuck them on the boys and try and find out exactly what they go through in training and in games. So we were the first international rugby team to use GPS. We weren't allowed to. It was illegal at the time, but we just chucked it on everyone. And then we kind of did a side deal saying, look, we'll give it to the referees and the other teams in warm-ups if they want to find out a little bit more about what they're trying to do. And then eventually it came in to everybody, and they changed the regulations.
Back then, there was obviously loads of awesome stuff that was going on. I'm sure there's loads of stuff I could be critical of if I really thought about it. The one thing I want to pull you up on now, though, and I know Chip will back me up on this, is how you approached new players, inviting them into training, because that caused me and Chip both a problem. Because I think, I don't know what your story is, Rich, but yeah, you left me a voicemail, Banj, and I had no idea I was even being looked at that stage. And obviously thought it was a prank, because why would I be getting a phone call from the coach of the England Sevens team? So I think I didn't ring you back for a couple of days, thinking that it wasn't a legit call. And you were the same, Chip, weren't you?
Yeah, I think you rang me first, and I told you to fuck off. And then Rusty rang me, and I was like, listen, lads, I was like, fuck off, I've had enough of this. Because that was a common thing we did at uni. We'd ring people up, say, hi, it's Dave Jones from the Cardiff Blues. We'd love you to turn up to Cardiff Arms Park. If you could be there at 8 a.m, that'd be great. And we'd have people from uni bowling into training at Cardiff Arms Park. So when I got the call, oh, you've been picked for England Sevens, I was like, yeah, okay, thanks very much, good one. Yeah, what was the crack with that, Banj? I think you actually messaged me on Facebook as well. I was like, the boys have really gone for it this time.
We tried to investigate every opportunity to find players. Any email or message or lead would follow up, even if it was some bloke's dad emailing saying they were the best player in the world, would follow it up. And some of those would go nowhere, and others, like your Jeff Williams, and like it was Ewick and Kirk, and with you, Chippy, and it was Bob Reeves with you, Mitch, and like you follow them up, like, and it'd be like, right, okay, let's find out what these guys can do. And your Jeff Williams of this world was a random email from his dad, and that worked out all right for him. And there's loads like that. I think you just got to be open when you're looking for talent to find everyone. And maybe I could do that in a more formal way to actually talk to you. But that is where. Well, you're all right now, aren't you? Like, look at the two of you.
Worked out all right. Worked out.
Chippy,
all right.
Worked out well.
You can afford a Monet in the background, Chippy. You're doing all right.
That's it. Yeah. I don't know. It could be a Monet. Imagine that. I'm at my Mrs. Mum and Dad's house. Banj. So apart from beating Noughts in a sprint, what is your favourite memory of coaching England?
Whoa. Ben, you beat Noughts in a sprint.
Let's not go there. It's like,
I've seen you in a few races, Banj, actually. You're specialist like, over the 1 metre and the 5 metre distances, aren't you?
Yeah, 1 and 2 metres was probably what I was better off. And I enjoyed those encounters with Daniel. I don't know, really. I mean, everything's got its highlights. You've got so many. It's a bit like saying who's the best player that you've coached, or like you have a coach.
Banj, I won't put you on the spot. We all know. Banj, me and you know.
You'll just get awkward.
I don't want to embarrass it.
I guess the point is, like, that people have their moments, don't they? Where one tournament somebody's killing it, another, and it's the same with coaches. Like, you have moments like Wellington, when we won Wellington for the first time, that was pretty special. I think Dubai, when we lost to Portugal in the first game, and then we had to beat Fiji by 8 points to go through as the group. And we did it on the last play. And then we knocked over third, second and first in the world, all on the last plays. Like, I put Rudders on in the last play on a kickoff against Australia that he caught and then passed to Dan Caprice. And we managed to edge that, did the same against New Zealand in the semis and then beat Samoa the in the final. So Dubai has got a lot of happy memories as well. And then London Sevens, the last time we won there, that was pretty cool. Sticking noughts on and doing a ridiculous arc, and then Mickey Young scoring the winning try in extra time. There are all sorts of things like that, I guess. They've all got their moments. I've had plenty of really disappointing ones that haunt me, like the Commonwealth Games semi-final, like the World Cup quarter-final in Dubai, like a Hong Kong quarter final against Fiji that is never, I'm never going to leave me on to what happened in that game. So those ones, they're the bad ones.
So Banj, obviously you've coached England and you've coached Fiji on the World Series. What is your like view on the approach of the other teams? So like, obviously, like when you were with England, it was a different approach. And when it was with Fiji, you were a different approach. Now, looking at the series now, what's your views on how different teams approach it? And do you think there's a perfect model for everyone, or is it different?
I don't think there's a perfect model. I think a lot of teams, you know, do have their own specific culture. I think a lot of teams tend to all do the same thing. You know, teams used to all do the same blowouts. They all seem to nutritionally be on the same sort of area. They're a lot of them tactically try to do things the same with a few nuances. There's no one at the moment that you'd go, they play the same game completely different, with perhaps the exception of Fiji. And even they've got a bit more structured in the last few years. So I think everyone generally does it well. I think also generally everybody gets on really well and they're quite open and they talk to each other, which I think is so unique and so positive for sevens that they do that well. I haven't really got any more to say on that, really. Fiji did things very differently from England. I do things generally pretty differently to most England coaches. I'm a bit more laid back. I do allow players a bit more autonomy. I don't sweat the small things as much as I used to. And I think Fiji helped me with that. And it always helps when, you know, Fiji did have so many world-class players that it's always going to make you more relaxed as a coach, isn't it? You know, if you know that the players turn up, they're going to be there or thereabouts every single tournament.
On the topic of other nation strategies, we had Rory McConachie and Marcus Watson on last week, which is pretty good crack. I'm sure the boys will testify to that. And inevitably, the question came up of players' transference from 15s to 7s, especially in Olympic year, because it comes on every player's radar. I might have an opportunity to get an Olympic medal. I don't think you drew on that too much with Fiji, unless it was out of necessity because of players having to go and play in France for the money. But where do you stand on bringing 15s players into the 7s program in Olympic year? I did try and ask Mitch and Chip this at the start of the season, but they swerved it very artfully. So I'm interested to hear where you're at on it.
Yeah, I think I'm all for it. I think it widens your pool as a coach. And if they're good enough, then they make the team. And if they're not good enough, then they don't. And it should be as simple as that, right? And you're not going to suddenly put a 15 star in if they're not good enough. And, you know, we had Jared Hayne try and have a late go. And, you know, he's obviously got a pretty, you know, glittering career behind him, but he wasn't good enough. So he didn't make it. And we had, you know, a few of the other boys that were playing in top 14, top try scorers in French rugby that didn't make the team. But then others did. And I think you have to allow that, you know, to happen. So, you know, if closer to home, if I was with Great Britain, I would sure, definitely would have earmarked and grabbed people and given them an opportunity during the season and then put them into a training camp at the end. And if they're good enough, then they get in. It's going to lift everyone's standards. I think people, you know, you can't start having arguments about, well, I've been in the system for so long and I'm the one that should be going to Olympics. You don't win Olympic medals like that. You win it by being the best team there. And so I would open the field up.
Give me some names, Banj. Who would you pick?
What, in the UK,
who would you take a look at?
I would have taken a look at Marrow. I think there's room for a big unit in the forwards that, that could be like that in sevens. You know, we had that with, you know, Leo Nakarawa and Bill Mata. You know, they look too big to play sevens, but they can really attract a lot of defenders and win you your set piece and give you a lot of confidence when you're walking out with a 6 foot, 720 kilogram unit that can run around. And, you know, and I would look at someone like that. Look, when I coached England's under 18s to the Junior Commonwealth Games gold medal, Anthony Watson was ridiculous. He really did stand out in that team. And you'd be looking at someone like that to give it a crack. And off the top of my head, you know, I could think of a few. You know, there's a couple of those back rowers in England that, that would have been probably got an engine that could survive and are good at the breakdown and disrupting, like James Davis did. So there'd definitely be quite a few that you'd look at, and you'd have conversations with them. You'd find out if they're decent people. And, you know, Saracens in the situation they're at now, a year in the Championship, surely they've had conversations with Saracens about getting some of those boys into the sevens program. If they haven't, then they've dropped a ball there.
I think Maro's budget is bigger than the rest of our our budget times 10, I think. To afford him for a month and bankrupt the RFU, I think.
You see, that's one of the questions, isn't it? It's a bit like Sonny when he came to New Zealand to the sevens and a few others. You know, they don't go for finances. They got to go for other reasons. And so, and that in itself is if someone like Maro decided, you know what, I am going to come in, and you know he's taken a massive cut financially, well, that shows you that he's prepared to give it a crack. So yeah, I think you should never shut the door to them. And I don't buy the fact that it takes months and months and months for these boys to get fit. They're a lot fitter than they were 15s players. And I think in a two-month, three-month window, you've got no problem at all about getting them to the right levels.
And why do you think there have been fewer players, this year, leading up to what was going to be the Olympics this summer, coming in than there were last year? Last time around, before Rio, we had Sonny Bill, Quay Cooper came in for Australia, like a couple of big names, couple of guys in the Fiji squad as well. South Africa kind of brought guys, came back for it. Why are we not seeing that this season?
I don't know. I mean, I think South Africa might still have had a go now with the British Lions touring South Africa at the same time as the Olympics, because they had three Springboks and then also Quagga Smith, who was going to be capped, playing as well. It's a good question why they haven't done it. I definitely still would have done it. And I know that some of them have had conversations. I think that the calendar hasn't fitted as well this time around. But I don't know the individual. I only know that if I was coaching, I would have done exactly the same that I did last time around with Fiji. You identify a group of players, you have conversations, you talk to their clubs 2 years ago, you then decide which tournaments you're thinking about playing them in, you'd airlift them in, you tell everyone that's going to happen, and then on the back of that, you decide to invite them or not invite them to your Olympic training camp, and then you make your decisions from there. That for me is a very straightforward way of doing things, and I definitely would have done that. And I know Fiji had conversations, so I think they probably would have done that. I think they would have had a look at your Semi Kunitanis and Leo Nakarawas and a few other boys that are bouncing around in the top 14.
Are you allowed to tell us if France were talking to Vaca Tower to see if he could make a return to the seven setup?
Look, Jérôme is across all of this. Like Jérôme Dallaire, the French sevens coach, you know, he's very well respected in the top 14. You know, he's coached at Dax to a high level. He's played for Dax at a high level, and he also played French sevens. And he's a very cerebral coach. He could quite easily be, you know, you see him involved in the top French side in years to come, I'm sure. And so he has had conversations with all sorts of current and close to test players, and they have got the availability outside their training squad, outside the French test squad, to choose players. And there's far more relationship now with the top 14 than there ever has been. And, you know, it's like night and day between that and what England have with the Premiership at the moment. And I think that you need to join those dots. You know, there's a lot of players sit on benches, don't do very much, that would benefit from playing sevens. So why not open that door as an opportunity?
100% banned.
Yeah, I think you're right. Just moving away from rugby for a minute, we talked a little bit about how since
Rio, you've kind of been doing a lot of different things, been in a lot of different environments, different team cultures, in and out of sport. Can you just give us maybe a couple of examples of ones that you've, environments you've been in, maybe sporting, maybe not, that have really inspired you or that you found really interesting, and kind of give us a bit of an insight into some of the things you've bounced into in the last three years, 4 years?
Wow. Crikey, I don't know where to start, really. I've been super lucky. So I've had a lot of doors that I've opened since Rio. And so whether it's, you know, hanging out in the NBA and seeing how they operate, I consult for Nike as well. So spend time in Portland and work with Nike Explore, which is research and development, really, projects. And so I get into their network and then chat to the various other people that are in our group. So that's in Prem football, and all the major sports, really. And with UK sport, I'm also a consultant. So I work across all their summer and winter sports. And I've seen some amazing practitioners where you're just gleaning lots of information about lots of things all the time, really. So it's constant, Mitch. I couldn't say to you, right, you go here for the best practice or of this, or I just see high levels of performance on and off the field everywhere. And I also see the same hurdles that a lot of top level teams and organizations fail at. Generally, egos are involved. Egos, so coaches, players, management owners, where their ego makes decisions not on based on performance, but on themselves, not creating a psychologically safe environment for the people that you're working for. So you're not creating safe conversations for your players. Players don't feel they can tell a coach exactly how they feel and what they don't feel like they've got belief and purpose. They don't feel like they've got enough autonomy. That's a really big one. In the NBA in particular, the teams that are normally at the top, their coaches have given them so much opportunity to do their thing, to mold the way they want to play, to put the onus on individual talent and skill, and really back players and back them publicly as well. And that then creates, you know, autonomy, which gives players belief. And then when you see it constrained, where it's too much coach led, where there's too much around what they want to do, you generally don't see the results as good as they could be. So I think there's stuff around that has kind of just hardened my philosophy on how you construct a team, you know, and whether that's, you know, trying to make yourself redundant as a head coach or just generally making things more transparent so that players genuinely feel like they're involved in the process, in decision making and in what everything looks like. And even little simple things, like I've been to a few NFL clubs where something as simple as they don't even tell their players what their program is for the week. And that really destabilizes a player's mental health. And it's something just simple. Just let us know what's happening that week. And it's something when the planning's wrong, or the coaches don't want to change things too much, or they don't get players to buy into the planning. Even something as simple as that can cause a real friction, amongst everyone. So a whole ton of things, really. Yeah, and I've been really impressed with football in this country. I used to think that rugby was better, that we were brighter, we were doing better things in sports science and in research and rehab, and I couldn't be further from the truth. You know, that in the Premiership, in the academies, and in the first teams, there's so much going on as far as very, very bright, resourceful practitioners that are world class. So it's no surprise, really, I guess, but I just didn't think that when I went into those environments.
Banj, you talk about the Prem clubs being kind of ahead of rugby in that way. What kind of innovations in technology would you bring in, or what have you seen that you could be used in rugby, or where do you think the future for it is going? Because we spoke to Augustin Pichot about views on innovation. He spoke about having a computer game and bringing people in via that way. But other things, kind of like the Rugby X we had about the ball sensor, what innovations in technology would you bring in, and where do you see it going? Sorry, it's a bit of a long-winded one.
It's all right. It's a bit like, I think, always ask yourself, like GB Rowing used to ask, you know, anything that they bring in, will it make our boat go faster? And so from a performance angle, anything you want to bring in from a tech point of view will it make you better? And if it doesn't, then don't use it. And a lot of Premiership football clubs have got so much data now. You know, it's not just the GPS unit and a heart rate monitor and an osmolarity hydration test, but it will also be various other things that it might have in their footwear to measure movement. They will have return to plays that week that will be on pressurized training ground fields. They'll have individual performance analysts and nutritionists. 70%, I think, of Premiership footballers now have also external help. So they have at least one person outside the club that they employ to help them, whether that's a chef or personal trainer or psychologist. So I think what I'm trying to say is there's so much noise around information that a lot of the Premiership clubs have actually pared that all down to just keep things simple so they can find their golden threads in all that data. But from a consumer point of view, I think we just need to make more of that available. So we need to start, you know, showing off how fast our players are, showing off some of those other data and statistics that can just bring the game to life. You know, in RugbyX, we're trying to, I mean, I've got some ideas that the rest of the guys at RugbyX get nervous about because they're extreme. But, you know, if you have a penalty, you know, have an overtime one-on-one, why can't the crowd choose who's going to do the one-on-ones? Why can't the crowd choose? You know, what if you had a World Series game, right? And again, this is where, like, bear with me. Some of this is ridiculous and you go, this is just stupid. England play New Zealand and it's a semi-final. And, you know, the crowd have chosen who their captain is that gets double points if they score, you know, and it just excites things. So for RugbyX, we can try all of that stuff because it engages that younger crowd that are used to all of those things. And I just think, you know, there's opportunity to just look at stuff and have the conversation and then start to see whether any of those are going to stick or not, really.
So you're a believer in technology, but you're clearly like a cerebral, pastoral driven coach. And correct me if I'm wrong, from reading your book and reading about you and talking to you, you saw your role at Fiji as sort of managing the personalities and sort of nurturing their development more than actually coaching them how to play the game. Is that fair to say?
I think it's definitely one of the serious aspects of it.
So with that in mind, is that why France have maybe brought you in? Or you can tell us more about your role with France, because I'm going to throw around a few stereotypes here that are always associated with France, say passion, upfront power, the Gallic maverick flair, but they walk hand in hand with their perceived mental fragility. And we've seen the effect that Sean Edwards has had on the 15-a-side team in the Six Nations. Is that a big role that you're playing for the Sevens team? We've seen a big improvement in them this season. I wondered how much attention you're paying to that aspect of the French team.
No, look, I mean, this season I've only spent about 12 days in country in France, really. And for the first time I was at a tournament with them, which is Vancouver, and they bombed out. So I wasn't a particularly good omen for them in that tournament. And it's mainly Jérôme and Christophe and the other guys there that are working really hard on raising the standards and talent IDing and getting better players into the system. There's some genuinely very good players in that team that will go pop out into the top 14 if they want to. And they've got a good age profile of that team. So I don't think it's that so much. I had a lot of options for different Sevens teams and I didn't want to go to any of them really. And the French was a combination of different things and I just thought it was interesting. And I like France and I got on well with the coach. So it's been kind of, you know, a real slow burner. I'm not really involved in any coaching. So I think, you know, all the changes you're seeing and them getting better is down to Jérôme really and the group of players, not me.
So I saw a quote credited to you saying that you would never head coach another Sevens team. But you mentioned earlier that if another Olympic opportunity came along, that would be very tempting. So is there a bit of a conflict there?
Yeah, I did say that and it would be very tempting. I didn't say it was necessarily going to be in rugby. In our performance directing is something I really enjoy. And I think overseeing programs, I think I could add a lot of value into. Going back to Chippy's point earlier about, I've seen a lot of the teams. I've seen a lot of things I think they could all do better and a lot of things they do really well. And I've had a lot of experiences since I left England. that I, you know, I'm a totally different coach to when I was when I left in 2013. And so, yeah, so I think I could add all of that. And the Olympics is just so cool. And I think I'd be a bit gutted if I thought Rio was my only taste of Olympics in my career in any form. So the doors are open for that. But head coaching in the series, I can't see going to another team. Yeah, I think that, you know, you that quote's the correct one. One night in heaven,
one night. On a lighter topic, Banj, someone when I put you on the Instagram story, someone replied saying, "Is that a ginger Hugh Jackman?" And I thought it would be good to just run through on a lighthearted topic a few of the lookalikes you've had over the years, because you've got quite a few, haven't you?
Yeah, yeah, it's good that you're bordering on being racist here. So let's go with this, yeah. so like anyone that's ginger, yeah. So you've got just a ton of people, including like I don't know, there's a Mo in Simpsons through to Hugh Jackman and Christ, I don't know. Like you probably know
Greg
more than
Rutherford.
Yeah, Greg, who I know. Yeah, he's a good looking lad. Got massive thighs. Yeah, so there's loads. I mean, because obviously we've signed the film rights for the book. It's not really based on the book. It's a slightly different story. The script's just been finalised. So hopefully, when coronavirus slows down, we can start to progress with that. And so there'll be someone that will probably be Ginger playing me. Although you can dye anyone's hair these days, can't you? Yeah, CGI.
Who would you choose?
Rodders.
I don't know who I'd choose. I mean, I don't know. I got no idea. And yeah, it'll be fun. I mean, the whole project's been fun to do so far. And, you know, the fact that the boys are going to get involved in it and it's going to show off Fiji and Rapati's going to be, you know, a major character in it, I think it's quite exciting.
Will it run all the way up to the Olympic final? And if it does, can I play myself in the final again? I'd like to relive some of that pain, please.
Well, there might be some opportunities there. I don't think it's going to be much of the final. That was kind of, that's the boring bit, isn't it? It's like not a lot happened in that final, Mitch.
I'd need a decent stunt double for some of that, to be fair. As you nice, kindly pointed out in the book, Banj, I picked up on that.
That's it.
I think they're going to get Perez in to play you, Mitch. Banj, who's better looking, Mitch or Perez?
Perez, which Perez?
Stephen Perez.
Yeah, I can see. I mean,
we don't
again,
look anything
like,
alike.
It's the hair, right? That's it. Hair and a bit of a beard.
That's it. See, I feel your pain now, Banj, of just being these shallow comparisons. It's unfair.
Yeah. Yeah, it's unfair. It's unfair.
I was just going to ask, last time the Lions tour came around, your name was in the mix quite heavily. Any eyes on that for the next one?
No. No, none cool. whatsoever. And yeah, my name was bandied around a lot. And then as soon as Warren Gatland heard it, he just completely dismissed that. So no, I think if I was involved in 15s, then ultimately that's something that you'd want to get involved in. But I'm not even on a training paddock with any teams at the moment. So that's certainly not on the agenda.
All righty. Funny how these things work out. What would be some advice you've had then for, because we spoke when we first started the pod, and one of the things we want to do is try and actually share a bit of learnings with some young players out there, boys and girls who are picking up the game. What would be some advice you'd give to some youngsters kicking on with the game now, whether it's sevens or 15s?
Yeah, I think it's like attend to your basics is the golden rule for me as a player, that you really get those skill sets as robust as you can, get into good habits, don't start to think about anything other. Sorry, I just locked Michelle out and just letting her in. Hold on, Michelle. Just on a podcast.
Hi, Michelle.
Hiya. Hi, Michelle.
I haven't taken the washing out either, so I'm going to get in trouble.
Oh, no, blame us.
So it's the same as we had to wait for Chip to change a nappy before we started recording. So,
so what was it? So yeah, all the foundations to get all them as good as you possibly could, and not try to chase things too quickly, or not try and think too far ahead. And for coaches, it's been like I remember when I was learning my coaching, I was coaching Newbury, I was coaching St Edward's Oxford, I was coaching Oxford under 21s, I was coaching Midlands, the schools and involved England schools and a couple of other, and Oxfordshire County. And I like literally just submerged myself in coaching as much as I possibly could. And it didn't really matter about the level. And I think so many coaches kind of want to have that premiership badge on, even if they're just doing, you know, 1 hour every month in a CPD or something, or and I think they just got to get on and learn their trade, because it is a craft, and you get really blunt really quickly as a coach if you stop coaching. So that's kind of my general advice. Sevens is a tough one though, because like I often get messages from coaches or players going, how do I get involved in that? What's the pathway for England sevens? And there ain't one. So it's kind of, well, refer to the RFU and ask them, but there isn't one. And I think that's something in the long-term plan, you know, that England could do to try to at least put a proper pathway in place. Because there's players out there and the game's changing. And I think, you know, sevens players, you know, might be changing as well. You know, no reason why they can't hold down some form of job as well as working, playing international sevens if the calendar allows. So there's different things.
I've got a suggestion, Ben. If you're, you know, a loose end and looking for a little project, why don't you come down to my club, your old club, Richmond, to assist in coaching us on our next tilt at the championship?
Well, Hilly was my forwards coach at Newbury for a year, and then I worked for him at Oxford Uni as well. So I've known Hilly for a long time. So I was, and they've got a brilliant minis and juniors. So I think, given the time, I'd quite like to do some stuff there, and because I started my rugby journey at Richmond.
Best club in the world. Anything else, Mitch?
No, I just want to milk you for all your worth, Ben. So I would just say, just to finish off, like you've mentioned a couple of things you've got in the pipeline coming up. We're looking at the second book. We're looking at the film. You're obviously doing a few things in terms of the coaching stuff in rugby. Anything else at the moment? You've got obviously still working with Rugby X. Anything you haven't mentioned that you're excited about?
Yeah, I'm excited about it. I'm working for a company called PlayX, which you might have seen me do a bit on social media. So they're basically like a money supermarket for professional sportsmen and women. So a place that you can go to get best deals, really, because it's not always that easy to get car insurance if you're a professional sportsman, or the right mortgage, or health insurance, or life insurance, or legal advice. And so, yeah, I mean, I think I'm quite excited about that. I think it's a genuinely valuable tool that both players and smaller agencies can use for free. So that's cool. And I enjoy doing stuff that's outside sport as well, you know, as I'm sure we all do. You know, there's lots of stuff out there that's really interesting.
Yeah, the thing we picked to do outside of sport was a podcast about rugby.
About rugby, yeah.
Sam, Banj, thank you so much for coming on.
Like, no,
really enjoyed it. I've been looking forward to it all week. That's top.
Yeah, Nort's messaged me as well how he's been looking forward to it, and we've hardly mentioned him, so he's just going to be scrolling through it quickly, and we're not going to talk about him at all, which is going to be a disaster for Strawberry.
A listen's a listen, Banj. We'll take anything.
Yeah, fair enough. One night in heaven,
one night. Finally. After talking about the man for 13 episodes, he comes on and Ben Ryan delivers.
Yeah, great to chat to him. Some awesome memories, actually, going way back to the beginning for me and you, Chip. But also, like, he's obviously, his skill is innovation, forward thinking, you know, disrupting the normal way of things. So it was cool hearing some of that firsthand.
Yeah, it's good to take a trip down memory lane with him. Obviously, Banjo the one who gave me my shot straight away from uni. Top bloke, thought he spoke really well. I particularly enjoyed when he was speaking about clarity from coaches. You know, even the little things, like he said about the week layout, like giving the team the week's layout, like something we brought in recently, probably the last 2 years, we had Simon even write the session out before we go out. And it just does give you a bit of like mental stability for the session, and same for the week. Like, you can plan where you're going to be, or you can say, I won't do this because I'm tired. Like, I think that's massive in sport and underestimated at the top level, especially.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, because there was part of me that thinks that if you give players everything, there also needs to be a time when you disrupt that. So when you don't give them what they want,
because then you learn to adapt and you learn to be all right with the unknown, which in sevens we know is massively important, because when you go to a tournament, stuff comes out of nowhere, stuff you don't expect, whether that's in-game or around. So I think the balance of the two is really important. But it was interesting to hear, like, we know from hearing about him and reading the book and stuff, how much his kind of philosophy as a coach has changed, and probably on life. Because that clarity was probably not something that was a massive feature of his coaching when he was with, well, from what I remember. And, you know, to hear him be much more at peace with that now is interesting. It's cool, I guess, just to see him, how he's developed and changed, you know, as we all hope we do over the years.
100%. Like the long old fitness sessions we used to have after a long old rugby session, and the fitness sessions, you never knew when they were going to end. It was kind of like run to that bin on the, we were in St Mary's pitches, weren't we? Run to the bin, wheelbarrow back, piggyback. It was all random and long.
I remember Rob Vickerman. I remember that session. Rob Vickerman literally couldn't move. He went into full body cramp because he refused to put a knee down, like to rest in between. It was awesome.
Yeah. No, it was horrible. Awesome was not the one. We had swimming in the morning as well with Karen Pickering, you remember?
I never had it. I came in after that. She finished at the end of that season.
Thought I was going to die.
Was it Ronnie Pickering? Was it? Fine, yeah.
Ronnie Pickering. Is that who I am? Sorry, Bernsey.
Is that interesting for you to be speaking to him so long after he initially coached you, and you can draw parallels with your journeys as players and his development as a coach and a man?
Yeah, kind of the last like 10 years is like I've known him for kind of 10 years. Like for my whole rugby career, I've kind of been in touch with him, kind of touching base at least like once or twice a year. Just so seeing him develop as a coach and a person, and me getting a bit older and a bit wiser and being able to identify how he's changed, it's really nice. Like it's always nice speaking to kind of old friends as well, and to see someone do so well and develop and become such a like great coach, it's always good to have him on.
Yeah, I think, I mean, as Chippy said, you're always very grateful for the coach who gives you your first shot at professional rugby and on the World Series. So I think we both really feel that. With him, there have definitely been times over the years where I've been confused by kind of seeing what he's saying and doing, because I'm like, oh, hang on, that's not how he used to do it. But obviously that's the point. And when you talk about sharing that development over the years, like my point of view on stuff now is way different to what it was 10 years ago or whatever. So yeah, it is cool, but I think it's nice to be at a point of maturity, I guess, where you can really appreciate his journey as well as my own.
Mitch, you noticed that Chip lost his bottle there when it came to Rugby X. Oh, episode one came out swinging. Oh, Rugby X is crap. Get Ben Ryan on. Oh, do you know what? I think, you know, these games is great because it never really works the first time a tournament, but there's room for improvement.
What have I just said about not begrudging someone development and a change of heart and a change of thought?
Bernsey, since we've been podcasting, I've become way more philosophical and deep, and I've appreciated that my initial reaction probably wasn't warranted. It was fueled by anger. And as Mitch said about player welfare, at the start, I wasn't contracted to be a Rugby X player, so I was kind of begrudgingly going. Looking back, in the benefit of hindsight, I've identified that Rugby X could be used in a better way, and that there was teething problems at the start, Joe. Are you happy with that answer?
Are they paying you, Chip? Are they started paying you?
Yes, all about the money.
The episode where Chippy sold out. Oh, RIP, the Northern Honesty.
Drop me in, by the way.
It was good.
He got in touch with us immediately after that episode. That's what prompted his interest. So it was already out there, Chip.
You're welcome. That's standard me pulling strings for the podcast. Yeah, again, professional LinkedIn podcast, I'll have you know.
I know you're a man of your words. Your word is your bond, Chippy.
That's it, boys.
Right, that's it from us for another episode in the clouds in Seventh Heaven. Thank you for joining us. Remember, like us, share us, subscribe to us on whatever platform you're listening to this on. But from all of us in Seventh Heaven, until next time, it is adios.
Certainly.
Goodbye.